Hello and welcome to News Click. Today we have with us Dr. Surya Sethi, principal and former principal advisor energy to the Planning Commission and a well-known energy expert. Surya, good to have you with us.
Thank you, Praveer.
The CAG report has raised serious questions regarding the production sharing contract with Reliance as well as with other companies. Do you think that the production sharing contract now will be reviewed by the government in light of the CAG comment, or is it that they will go with the same policies as they've been doing in the past?
See, there are many flaws in the production sharing contract, and it is not for the first time that these flaws have been pointed out. The big flaw that CAG has pointed out is he calls it a perverse kind of incentive where the government share actually reduces if the capital cost goes up. Okay. I personally don't think that is that as bad as it is being made out to be, that issue. The problem is not what happens to the government share, because remember, we are an energy-starved country and we need more energy. So if we can recover an additional amounts of energy with putting in extra capital, it may be well worth it, given the fact that we are energy-starved. The problem with that is that we have no clue what the right capital cost should be for extracting a certain amount of energy. So, as I say, corruption and stealing and corruption, they are all perverse if you have no fear of getting caught. So the problem is not that the costs go up and we recover some extra energy. The problem is we have no clue what the right cost to recover that energy was, and that is the essence of the problem of D6 and the CAG report.
It went up from 2.5 billion to 8.8 billion. And according to CAG, even this is likely to go up even further.
It will go up further because if you are to produce 80 MMCMD of gas from that field, it will not produce with this amount of what investment has taken place. In fact, if it will ever produce that, I'm not sure. But the point I'm trying to make is that neither are we sure whether 2.2 was correct, nor are we sure whether 8.8 is correct. So we simply, there's a tremendous amount of asymmetry of information between the people who are putting up these costs and the people who are approving these costs as legitimate.
There are two other issues that are involved. One is, of course, the fact that there's an exploration area out to which you are supposed to hold only the discovered area as well as the production area. But in the case of Reliance, it's been allowed to hold 100% of the area's exploration area. So the development area and the production area would be only 5% of this area. Do you think that this is something which immediately needs action?
I think CAG has done great service in pointing out that this contract has been violated in this respect. We haven't yet heard the explanation, at least the general public hasn't heard the explanation from the other side as to how come that this happened, because this is very well laid out in the production sharing contract, whereby you have to relinquish areas that you've not actually started production from within a given period of time. Now, how that was not implemented in this, I think, is the biggest single contribution that I found out of the CAG report, because even I was not aware that this is actually happening. Okay. Now, as I said, I haven't heard the other side of the story, but I don't know what explanation they'll come up with as to what prompted the CAG to permit this. But as far as the PSCs are concerned, this is a clear violation of the PSC.
All the production sharing contracts seem to take international parity price as the basis, for oil at least. For gas, it was fixed by the EGOM headed by Pranab Mukherjee at $4.2 per million BTU. When the cost of gas, as per the case that they fought with Reliance, fought with Anil Ambani's Reliance, was that the cost, they would have made profit even if it was sold at 2.34 per million BTU. Now, what justification is there for setting such high prices? And plus the fact that it is set in international terms, oil price and index to oil price and foreign exchange, the dollar.
You know, Prabir, I have a very personal grudge here, because I showed to that EGOM samples from 53 or 63 countries, I forget, of how gas is priced. And I showed them that not one of the countries prices gas the way we were pricing gas. The problem is that what we are talking of here is natural gas. The way natural gas is priced is very different from the way LNG is priced. And what we agreed to do was to price natural gas as LNG. Not only we agreed to price natural gas on a formula-based LNG level, we also agreed to a formula which had no resemblance with the formulas used for LNG pricing also in the world. And this was categorically in writing told to the EGOM, and they still did not listen. Now, the fact of the matter is that $4.2 wellhead price for natural gas, and I again emphasize natural gas, is the highest price anybody has ever received for natural gas anywhere. And while you say cost of production, you know, the various figures came out, somebody said $1, but nobody has claimed that the cost of production is more than $1.43 or some such number, for $1.43. But there are numbers to show that it's probably 99 cents also. But wherever they are, the maximum number is $1.43. Now, why under that situation were we paying $4.2 is completely beyond me, at least. As I said, this was discussed, this was demonstrated that this is not the way to price natural gas, but yet the EGOM in its wisdom decided to go with that price.
One part of the cost that you are talking about, of course, is the cost of $8.8 billion investment, capital investment. And though the CAG hasn't really gone into the details of this, there are some reports to indicate that this was approved, $2.5 billion to $8.8 billion was approved in a matter of something like 53 days. You also said that the government really does not have the expertise on this. Have they done any studies to indicate what this cost should be, or any normative costing to understand how these prices have been arrived at?
Time and again, this issue has come up. This is not the first time that this cost increase came up. I mean, today we have a CAG report, but internally this issue was debated time and time again as to how this cost increase has been approved. And at least I, in the 8 or 9 years that I was in the government, I did not see any legitimate justification for this cost increase.
Production sharing contracts, has the government ever received what it was committed by the oil companies or the companies like Reliance?
See, that's a very good point that you have asked. See, the problem of all this is one point which I think even the CAG has missed, is that when we say that the government share rises as you achieve a certain investment multiple, the underlying assumption is that by the time you achieve the investment multiple, there would be some resource left to share. But if you actually look at the numbers and the capacity of these wells, there will be no resource left to share by the time that investment multiple is achieved. So that's the beauty of this rising capital cost, because with rising capital cost, investment multiple is assured. And by the time you've recovered or reached that investment multiple, there'll be no gas left to share. So no matter, you may give the government 85% share beyond a certain investment multiple, but 85% share of a zero is still zero. That's the hard reality which hasn't yet come out of the CAG report. And I have been asking as to show me, among the private fields, I don't want, ONGC is a separate kettle of fish, but among the private fields, I would love to know how much has profit petroleum or how much profit gas has the government benefit till date on private fields.
Effectively, what it would seem to imply, therefore, is by cooking the capital cost figures. By the way, this is also the Enron case, that you cook the capital figures, of course, you get a higher price. By cooking the capital cost figures, you make profit really in two ways. One is, of course, you recycle the funds back to the company. And second, of course, is that you also get, as you said, the share of the profit petroleum, which doesn't therefore go to the government. But there is a third issue. By inflating all this, Reliance can also boost its stock price. And this is one of the things which Reliance seem to have been doing continuously.
Well, again, if you look at the earlier balance sheets of Reliance, to the best of my knowledge, the DGH by then had only certified 7 trillion cubic feet of gas, but the reports were claiming much differently from there. This would not happen elsewhere in the world. This only was possible here, and yes, that does impact stock prices. The deficiency is independent regulation and regulation of by people who know this sector, who people who are experts in the sector, who are equal in their, there's no asymmetry between their knowledge base and the private sector, whoever is proposing these things to them. And unless we get that kind of regulation in place with that kind of expertise and that level of independence, we will always face these problems where we don't know whether 2.2 is right or 8.8 is right, or neither is right.
So a lot of this could have been just this increase of gas reserves, as Reliance claimed, without a verification, could very easily have been just to boost the stock price and recover some money.
Well, we see the results today. You know, they said that they can produce 80 MMCMD. Today, from whatever I'm reading in the, you know, from my friends I'm gathering, this may turn out to be one of the biggest disaster fields of the country, because they're not even able to produce today at, I think, 43, 44 MMCMD. Which was the original level. Everybody felt that at 40 MMCMD, the field will last 14 or 15 years. But I have never seen data to confirm that 80 MMCMD, the field life would still be real. You know, you can extract 80 MMCMD from the same field, but you will kill the field in 3 years or 4 years' time.
Which is what could be happening, as we see from what the data is of production.
So, the government can wait for 85% share of something that will never show up.
Thanks, Surya. I think this has been a very interesting discussion. And let's see what the government reply is going to be the draft CAG report. I think that will at least bring out what the issues are.
I look forward to reading that myself.
Thank you.
Thank you.